Buzz Toad, 7 Legacy Oaks Place. I believe it's on slide 3. You mentioned that at the last rate increase discussion, that council asked you to spread the increase across all rate classes. I have two questions, actually. One is, your fixed charges, you state that it's going to be a 29 cent increase, but it's only affecting residential customers.
No, that's not correct. We just pointed that out because we knew that would be of the greatest interest to those in attendance.
So
it's 2.75 is also applied to those availability charges, and for residential customers, it means 29 cents.
So commercial, industrial, all the
correct
sectors.
Okay.
That's and correct. How did you arrive at the 29 cents was the 2.75%?
Correct. Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Singhal.
Hey, Joe. I'm Ruchi Singhal. I live at 9 Braywick. I'm also the CEO founder of Nexus Energy Center. And I've heard a couple of elderly people or people concerned about the increase. It does seem like on average about $4 increase a month, which is definitely worth it for reliable power. But I will say there are opportunities out there for people to be energy efficient and save even more than $4 a month so that the increase won't affect you. And that Nexus Energy Center is helping bridge the gap. Colonel Olszewski was talking about wanting to help people with gas, and I know that they're brainstorming those ideas. In the meantime, Nexus Energy Center has the Comfort Project, and if you're somebody who wants to save energy in your home, we have no restrictions on whether you can make it or not, and we have small grants that have come to us to help fund that. And so Nexus Energy Center is here to help you, and I have business cards today that you can take and call if you need. But I do want to ask real quick to Huntsville Utilities about efficiency programs in general. I think that I understand as a business you're always going to need to find revenue to cover the costs that you have. But I want to know more about your investments into efficiency programs. We were, as a team, looking at a little bit about how much you spend on efficiency programs, and I want to know if that's going to change or increase into the future, and if you'd be willing to work with partners to kind of help your customers.
Well, you know, we've had conversations many times about opportunities that are out there. Going forward, most of those programs we run through and with TVA. We're aware that there are some changes coming. We're not aware yet how that's going to look. We will continue to do the new homes program as we do. We are by far and away the number one in the valley for new homes energy efficient construction. We will continue with our efforts towards making that construction energy code compliant, which is a great step towards efficiency. And we get, you know, upwards of 1,200-1,300 homes a year in that program. So as a service area, we are getting more efficient as we grow, which is a great new story. That's what has kept us in the lead for the Georgetown University Prize competition every single quarter, and it's just ended. We may well win that. And so if the city is awarded that prize, then we can have some more discussions about new energy efficiency efforts
and
opportunities for our existing customers who perhaps don't meet the low income criteria, but with a little help, maybe with a little low interest financing or some sort of revolving loan fund, and there would be no restrictions on gas customers. You know, that was a very hard pill for us to swallow as we got into the grant award for the HEAM program, but you know, we took what we could take to help who we could help, and we've done that. So going forward, yes, we're always open to those conversations. Don't know what that will look like, but historically we do most of that stuff with and through TVA. Door's always open, you know where to find me. Yes, sir.
Yes, Larry Thomas, Natalie Henderson. Got a question. Maybe Clean but can have some say on this too. This is kind of a combination question for both Huntsville Utilities as well as our city council. I really wish for any development over a certain $1 million amount that Huntsville Utilities get free access to construct a certain percentage of rooftop solar from those projects. And that has to work in developer costs for those big dollar projects. And that way, you would, and also be given free use of a percentage of the parking space for solar shaded parking. So basically gives you free access to land that's open for solar development. Because I know one of the big things that's happening to a lot of the utility companies for when residential customers move on to solar, then you get kind of hit with kind of like the rates that rates tend to go up because people aren't as dependent upon the grid anymore. But anyways, and if Huntsville Utilities were to act on the construction, which nothing says that you would have to do so, it would give you the capability to keep costs low for all customers and create additional green jobs and industry in our area. The remaining percentage of space could be used by the company. Additionally, if Huntsville Utilities does not take advantage of the space within 2 years, the company or business occupying the area may utilize the full space for its own solar project. And if the company does not utilize their percentage of space that it's granted to Huntsville Utilities, this is only fair because they have to meet additional regulations to build the standards and get both motivation for seeing development occur in this field. Anyways, just
it's an interesting idea. We're getting into a lot of areas there that we don't get into, but the first problem with that proposal is our power contract with TVA. You may have heard earlier, I don't know if you were here earlier when we were having that discussion about we're not in the generation business. However, TVA does offer opportunities. Randy got up and spoke to them a little bit, Mr. Buckner, about opportunities that are there for property owners, for our customers, for any customer in the valley. But what you're talking about there gets into development regulation and construction and things that we don't generally do on private property. And so, yes, you would need Mr. Kling's help with a thing like that because you would be getting into a lot of city regulation that we're not involved with.
But would that be something that Huntsville Utilities would possibly?
Perhaps. I mean, that's a conversation we would need to have with TVA and TVA. But again, I'll go back to the comments previously about their interest in distributed energy resources. You may be aware that our former CEO accepted a position with TVA, and his title is Senior Vice President of Distributed Energy Resources. So TVA is moving in that direction. And that's a good news story for customers because as they get into those resources, they think that that will begin to lower their required investment in the generation that's required to provide you reliable service. Anyone else? Ms. Reed?
One more.
Yes, ma'am.
I would just like to ask if the big developers that come in this city were fixing to do a monster job, millions, supposedly in 20 years anyway, do they put money up front? And do you have the paperwork where we could see when a big development lays their money on the table to you all for a big development, say like the Madison Square Mall? And when they start that mess with all these houses and all that development going on out there, who is going to put that money up, the city of Huntsville or the developer? I mean, I'm just asking a common sense question.
Okay, well, I'm going to let our Vice President of Engineering address that, but what you're talking about is aid to construction. And yes, yes, ma'am, and developers are required to put up quite a bit for us to extend service to their developments.
And they put it up front. They don't wait for 20 years to put it up. They put it up front.
It is paid up front before we'll even start construction of the project. So when a project like that comes in, we estimate what it's going to cost to do that work. We estimate the revenue that will be returned from that project, and then the developer is required to pay the net. So that's how that works, and that's paid up front before we start construction.
So somebody can find out the paperwork. How much you put down on some big project.
That's true.
If you're looking for it. Thank you.
And that's not just in Jackie, that's not just in electric, it's the same in water. Yes, it's an ATC associated with the project. Developers pay it before the project ever starts.
I know. I've been there to the board meeting
sometimes.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Are you able to provide the percentage of homes using gas versus electricity and do not qualify for the HEM project?
Take rates about 20%.
Go ahead, Jay.
particularly in Northwest Huntsville.
So that's a little bit difficult because there is more than just the requirement of does it have gas or is it all electric? So because there also is based upon the age of the house. So there's an age requirement of, I think, 20 years. And then there's also a requirement based upon the income of the people that live in the house, and also it has to be owner-occupied. So we don't have all that information in our systems. We don't know, generally we don't know when the house was built. Generally we don't know when the income of the resident. And generally, we don't know if it's either a rental property or a homeowner. Now, we can get you information about how many houses have gas and how many houses are all electric. We do have that kind of information. But as far as getting down to the specifics of saying, okay, this many homes were eliminated from the HEME project because they had gas, is very difficult without knowing all those other factors. Does that make sense? So first of all, you have to own your home. You have to meet an income requirement, be below a certain income level, and that's based upon HUD numbers, and that's based upon how many people live in the home. And then the home has to be at least 20 years old.
Okay, so they apply for you. You all don't suggest.
No, ma'am. So we have that out there, and then people can come to us. In fact, is Harry Hoff, you still here?
Well, Hillary's still here.
Hillary Gould is here, and if you have questions, if you think you may meet the criteria, or a neighbor or a relative or whomever, a friend, get with Hillary, and she can get you her contact information, or you can get with me, and I can give you my contact information and get you to the right person too, because we're happy to get as many people into that HEME program as we can. We're very proud of that project.
Okay, folks, we got about 20 minutes left. Reverend Johnson.
As I remember, there was a comment made that businesses would be excluded on the original request based upon TVA requirement. And one of my questions deal with, would you go back and negotiate with TVA and they decided it was okay for businesses and now we include them?
I'm going to try and answer that, and then I may need Ted or Ron's help. The original proposal was based on a rate study that we had done, and that rate study recommended that we only raise rates on those two customer classes in the original proposal. It was the residential and small commercial. When council did not like that approach, nor did the people attending those meetings, we take all that information back with the input that we received and make a new proposal to TVA. All TVA is looking for is that we meet all our contractual obligations to them. And so it was not a recommendation based on TVA as to why we came with that first proposal with just the two rate classes. What council asked us to look at was applying it across the board, which is what we're proposing now. Does that make sense, Mr. Johnson?
Yes, I just want to say that I was here and the question was asked, why were they excluded? The answer came back because TVA suggested that businesses be excluded, but I'll go back and check my notes on that part. How many employees do you have?
600.
What's the payroll, annual payroll?
We don't have that information with us. We can be sure to have it when we come back.
For 2013, it was $32 million, I believe it was. Also, if you're going to do that out of that for 14, 15, and 16, the annual payroll plus the number of employees that were on loan, I'd also like to know how much we paid to resource our meter reading. Do you have an answer to that for 2015, 14, 16? How much we paid to outsource the meter reading?
I'd like to go verify this number, but I'd say to you it was $2.1 million. first time we outsourced for a year.
So we kept 18 employees at that time who were former meter readers. Do you think that 18 employees would have been paid $2 million for reading meter readers for ourselves? I'm strictly thinking management here as opposed to anything else. We outsourced and paid $2 million to get a job done that we were paying 18 people to do.
It was more than 18, but I mean, like I said, I would like, I don't have any problem to TC that do that, go back, get our numbers, and go over that with you.
Well, I was at that meeting also, and we was told that there were 18 jobs that would be brought back into hospital, and you would get the job.
I believe it was more than 18, sir, but we'll.
So I believe, Mr. Johnson, that we had 18 people left in meter reading. So as our meter reading staffs, so that's a hard job. Meter reading's a hard job, and so we had a lot of attrition in that area. And what was happening was that as people were leaving, retiring, whatever reason they were leaving our employment, we were bringing on some contract employees. And then when we went with the full contract with Heath Associates, who does our meter reading, there were 18 folks left in meter reading. We kind of had a plan that we were working over several years on that. And then when we signed it off on the contract for them to take over meter reading completely, we had 18 employees left, and we found other positions within the organization for those 18 folks.
So how many did you have before you were left with 18?
Yeah,
I think it was
32. And the contract also included the equipment, trucks and vehicles and things like that, which we, it was not just the employees.
They really expense on this report, this cost of service for the total system is $1.5 million.
So that may be for electric, and that they read all of our meters. So John's number probably included all three systems.
So you say you had 601 employees or something like that?
About 640.
How much do we pay insurance for those 640?
You know, Janice, you know, approximately $9 million.
$9 million.
And it includes retirees.
Got 200 in retirees?
Yeah, probably.
They do pay the retirees Blue Cross Blue Shield.
And so the number that we paid, how much was that? I get confused listening.
Well, I mean, we can get you that number for sure, but Janice, our HRVP, is thinking it's probably $9 million for insurance.
I'm close to $9 million, but that includes pay for all of our retirees.
And I can't really get that information. Is it really broken out in your budget, profit and loss, whatever? Would that be itemized in your budget?
Yes. Yes, it will. We can get that.
Is it possible to get a copy of the budget for 13, 14, 15, 16?
We should be able to get that
itemized.
Budget.
I can do that?
Yes, sir.
How much do we pay for legal retainment and services on an annual basis?
I'm sorry, I don't. I'll just have to get that information for you. I don't have that in front of me.
The finance guy is too.
So I'm sorry, I don't know the numbers off the top of my head either, Mr. Johnson. But we can go through the budget with you and do that.
Yeah. When was the last raise that the employees had cost in total?
It was this year.
How much was it?
It is 1%.
There's an allegation that open level management receives 7%. Is that true? It's a rumor in our community that open level management received a 7% increase. If that's not true, I'm glad of it, because I would like to have it that way.
We had a GWI, which is called general wage increase. I think it's 1%.
So everyone employed got the same rate increase.
That's correct.
So Liz wanted to make you just look bad. I understand that. When was the last time customer service fees were increased?
I can speak to that. Customer service fees for like turning power on and off hasn't been increased in over 3 years now.
Is there a future increase of that?
The answer is, my intent is no. Well, I mean, we don't, I have to run that up the numbers, and I'm gonna brief it, and my piece of that is, it hasn't been raised 3 years, because we, I came in 3.5 years ago and felt it was where it was, and that we needed to stand still on that, and with everything else going on, that's where we stood on it. Now, my goal is not to come in here every week and raise the rate. I'm sharing with you that my numbers that I do as customer care does not need a requirement of a rate increase in my area of customer care. And my area is applications, you coming in doing a, for instance, when you came, if you came in to this city 3 years ago, 2 years and 1 year ago, and you did your application online, which you couldn't do 3 years ago, and you have a good credit rating, your deposit's $100. It was $300. So I mean, I can share with you that we haven't had a rate increase, TCS, as simple as it has, on fees is what you just asked.
You don't talk about the Dunning thing too.
I can share with you on another area.
Not because it's cut those fees.
Well, one of the reasons we were able to keep the fees stabilized is what we were doing to our customer base was, and it was partly because we hadn't had SAP yet, but you had to come in on day 14 when your bill was due, and then if you couldn't pay it on day 14, when you had 14 days, you had to ask for a 12-day extension, and you had to drive down to the company to do that. And that just, and we were given it. We were given it as part of our business. We did the Dunning, which is our way of recalculating and doing some programming and everything, and it added 12 days into it. So now, low-income folks that are having problems paying their bills, it comes in on the 14th, they have till 26, 27 days to pay it now. And that's something we did in the last 3 years as well.
And the online works excellently. I would suggest anyone go online. And I appreciate working with you and helping others to are unable to pay their utility bills. Every week we work with the office to ensure that gets done. Your team works wonderfully with us in that regard. Having said that, if a house in Edmond Heights decides to go all electric and meet all the other qualifications, would they qualify for the program that you're talking about?
The program was talking about was 20 years.
I got all that other
part. But they have to come in, it's 20 years. I'm going through all that for you because it's 20 years, it's owner occupied and income based on HUD numbers. And I'm making this number up, but it's 26 something. $1,000 a year, and then you got one person or two person that goes up a little bit. And then we come out, our team goes out and inspects the house to make an assessment of how to get to that 25%. We make if it meets all that criteria, it makes an assessment to see if we get to what 25 is, whether it's an HVAC and windows or insulation. I got somebody else who wants to answer the question, so I'll let him answer the question.
Can I just ask the question again, because I know all the stuff has just been said. I presently have a house that's gas, hypothetically, in that area that the gentleman was speaking on. I make a determination that I want to get off gas. I'm going to get off gas. And I meet all those other qualifications. Now I have an electric AC unit. If I meet all those other qualifications, is it possible then for me to get the assistance that you're talking about?
No. Short answer is no. So the grant will not allow us to, if you pull your gas out in an effort to receive this grant, it doesn't allow us to do that. So we've tried to work with EVA on that. We've even been in places where the gas furnace doesn't work.
I mean, it's okay.
I understand your question, and I wish I could say yes, but here again, you know, we're a grantee. We asked, you know, for this. We didn't get to make all the rules, if a home has gas right now and somebody says, well, hey, I'm just going to pull my gas out, you know, come pull the meter, and then apply for it, the answer is going to come back as no. So just be upfront with you. Go ahead.
Just want to add, Pastor Johnson, the reason is because you have to have had a history of using electric heat, because it's an electric grant, and we have to show that we're taking strain off the electric grid. So if you just flip over to electricity, that home didn't have a history of putting a strain on the electric grid.
So that's TVA's explanation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
week, but I'll tell them today. When was the last time water rates increased? And is there any future in it going up?
Last year was the end of a five-step increase that was associated with funding the water treatment plant that we're currently constructing in the southeastern, but it's really in Marshall County, but it will serve primarily the southeastern portion of our service area.
And so that there is no future increase in water?
No, we are not projecting any increases in the foreseeable future.
When were the last gas rates increased, and will there be any of those in the future?
We have not increased gas in quite a few years. In fact, we decreased the gas rate last year.
Another place to apologize.
Thank you.
The last question deal with public lighting around the city. Is that paid for by the city or?
That's complicated, surprisingly, but yes.
Everything has been.
Yes, that one is. Stacy, you want to? That one's a bit of a mess.
It is.
Well, the simple answer is yes. The city pays for city street lighting, and the county pays for their street lights. So whatever entity is responsible for that area pays for those street lights.
So the city of Huntsville writes a check to Huntsville Utilities paying for that. How much does that mean?
I'm not sure what that is. It's pretty high.
Okay. Now, do Huntsville Utilities take care of the technical stuff?
That's correct.
Is that LED?
Not yet.
We're encouraging citizens to LED, and we must. Of course, I'm looking at another. You're going to get a raise if you say that. You're going to get an increase. Are we? We have a plan to take that burden.
And that's, we're studying that. But as you know, at least right now, LED technology is quite a bit more expensive, and so that's something we'll have to look at. And it will probably be a slow move. A gradual move to LED, but that's a conversation we have with the city regularly.
Okay. So if someone's going to let me know how much it costs the city on a monthly basis, for
we will put that on the list.
I'm going to do that. Mm-hmm. Someone's going to let me know what the payroll budget is. Someone's going to let me know exactly how much it costs relative to insurance. And someone's going to tell me how much legal expenses we pay for retaining service on an annual basis. And some of them tell me specifically how much the outsourced meter reading cost and how many meter readers we had prior to that.
We've got a list.
Hey guys, I appreciate your work, especially when you have to talk to me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody. You keep us on our toes always. Folks, we are nearing the end of the 90 minutes, and we had allotted for the meeting. Yes, ma'am.
Simone Cooper, South Huntsville, currently. My question, back with the rate increase. For example, I'm glad you guys brought up like seasonal rates and all that stuff. So, for example, in November, my bill was about $40-something. December came around, it was $140-something. So I can assume that is due to those seasonal increases in rates or whatever, right?
It's a combination of things.
Combination.
Yes.
Okay. But also, it's a combination.
No.
But also, the weather was different in December.
However, I did not use the same amount, nor even close to the same amount. Okay.
And Will, you may have a problem, or there's a number of things that could be at play there. And let me say this to everyone here, because that's a comment that comes up frequently. You know, I my habits didn't change, the weather was nice. If you think there's a problem with the bill that we're sending you, please call us. We'll look at that. We'll go over that with you. We have energy survey programs where we'll come out and evaluate your house. It's $50 if you don't implement any of the recommendations. But if you do, the survey's free. So there are a number of things that we can do to help understand why your bill was unexpectedly high. We will definitely take a look at that.
Wait, and was that your total utility bill?
Yes, okay. 140 something. Okay. From the previous 40 something.
It wasn't just electric though.
I'm sorry? It wasn't just electric. Yeah, right. It was a combination of
Yeah, we need to look at that.
Okay. Yeah. And then why is not like the seasonal and the weather that not itemized in my bill? Why can I not see the breakdown? If you can break down like the...
Between the winter, summer, transition changes and stuff?
Isn't that information on the back of the bill? That information's on the back of your bill.
Well, we'll help you with that.
Okay, thank you.
Be happy to help you understand.
Okay, thank you.
One question.
Yes, ma'am.
I don't want to think I lived in my mind, and it's bothering me, I don't want to go home thinking that. When was the last time the gentleman that was ahead of the utilities before you came in, he was here at this meeting, and y'all asked for $2.59. What were you asking for that money for at the city council that night when he was here, and that was his last meeting? What were you asking for that money for that night?
Same thing.
That was the proposed rate increase, and it was in two steps, if I recall. It was, the total was $4.90. Well, there was a lot of discussion that night, and there's a lot of conversation going on. But what we proposed was a two-step increase to availability, and it was a $2.50 and a $2.40.
Thank you. Yes, I heard that.
Yeah,
and that would affect the May
and one in October.
And what month was that?
April.
Sir, I got to pull the city council. I'm not losing my mind. It was in August, 2 weeks before the election. I'll bring it to you and I'll get on TV and let you know.
Please do.
Because he was here. When did he quit?
October.
September 30th.
Yeah.
It was availability rate.
Yes, we know that. Yes, it was.
Okay, last question.
All right. Gerald Johnson.
This will be the last one, Mr. Johnson. Thank you.
No relation to Pastor Johnson.
There'd be nothing wrong with that.
She says
it was a meeting in August.
There wasn't been any.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, folks. Well, Ms. Reed, if you want. Yep.
I'm going to lose my mind. I don't want to go home thinking I've lost my mind.
No way.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
When did you guys see smart meters coming across the board?
So that'll be a slow rollout. We're currently, if I may, Tony, we're currently testing some equipment right now on our system. And it's a moving target because often things would come up, but what we're looking at is hopefully before the end of this year, we'll begin deploying that technology.
Okay. Now, once that is deployed, that's going to open up something new to Huntsville, which is going to be peak hour coverage.
Time of use
and things like that. Are you guys, do you have to propose like you're doing now for that type of increase? Or is that something that you just have the ability to do because of the technology?
No, we would have to have TVA's approval.
Right, because that will affect the contract that we have with TVA. But that's a direction that TVA is encouraging all their power companies to go, and we are on that path.
Yeah.
So inevitably, it's going to come to that point. So what about just let go of the rate increase for now and allow revenues to be generated once the smart meters come in for those peak hour usages?
Because I personally think we're several years away to have an AMI in place and a rate structure in place where we can do that. It's, I don't know, Stacy, the pilot, we've got about 200 meters in a pilot program that we'll be kicking off probably in the next month or so. And to kind of work out the bugs and things like that and all the data. Stuff, and then we'll roll it out. Of course, we'll roll it out with electric, water, and gas, and that kind of thing. So, just the logistics of changing out, 350,000 meters, is going to take them out. And we can't do something like that until the whole system is changed out and functional.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right, folks, we're coming up on 6:30. I want to thank you all so much. This is a great turnout. A reminder, we will be appearing before City Council this Thursday night. Their meeting starts at 6, and they also have a public comment period. Once again, thank you for coming out. We'll be with them at the work session on January the 19th, and then we will be asking for Council to make a decision on the 26th. Thanks again for coming. Please be safe on your way home.